Здравствуйте!
Hello! Today we go back to the past, to the American Revolutionary War. It is 18th of September, 1777. British General Burgoyne's forces reach a position near Saratoga. His forces are fewer in number than American ones, led by General Gates, though they are better trained and equipped. Exact number of troops differs depending on the source and whether the personnel were combat troops or auxiliary personnel, for example, for logistic purposes. The next morning, a battle will ensue at the nearby Freeman's Farm. It was to be one of the battles that some say changed the course of American Revolutionary War. But story of battles of Saratoga is more than just soldiers exchanging fire. It features long-term strategy, importance of communication, morale, allies and logistics. At that point, the war had been going on for a year and a half. By late 1776, the British realized easy defeat of US separatists wasn't going to happen. They singled out New England as the hardest region to pacify. Thus a plan was devised: isolate New England so they could concentrate on southern regions, where they believed British loyalist support was greater. General Burgoyne was to lead a sizable force from up north, alongside the River Hudson. Another force, led by St. Leger, was to present a diversion, coming down to Mohawk River Valley. Two forces were to meet up in Albany, and also meet up with a large British force going up from the south, led by General Howe. They hoped that by keeping this line, New England would be cut off. But there seems to have been miscommunications within the British High Command. It partly stems from the issue of British generals of the time making up their own ideas and campaigns, separate of each other. General Howe, while aware of the outlines of the master plan, previously prepared for an attack on the city of Philadelphia. Lord Germain, British official that was managing the war, okayed Howe's attack on Philadelphia. But communication, done sporadically via letters taking days to travel, was lacking. In one letter, Germain okays the attack on Philadelphia with no mention of meetup in Albany. In another letter, the order acknowledges the attack on Philadelphia, but states it should be done so a timely meetup in Albany is possible. That letter, however, reached Howe too late. By then, logistics of marching towards Philadelphia were already underway, and a route was chosen which did not lend itself to easy and quick relocation of forces towards Albany. Burgoyne's forces included both British soldiers and soldiers provided by certain German states of the time, and contracted by the British Army. Burgoyne used his Native American allies as a screen, both for recon and as means of a buffer, not letting the Americans know where exactly British troops were. He also fought battles on his way down the River Hudson. One of most notable ones was his taking of Fort Ticonderoga. American forces were retreating from Burgoyne, making his life miserable as much as they could. They burned down farm fields and cut trees over the roads to slow him down and wear out his forces as much as possible. Slowing down such an army meant it was using up food and resources while not contributing towards its objective. St. Leger, commander of the force coming from the west, had at one point 2,000 troops. But the unity and morale of said force was not that great. Some Indians in the area were fighting for the British and some against them. Then the Battle of Oriskany and American raid on nearby Indian camp happened, further dividing the natives. Indian contingent with the British force withdrew, taking supplies with them. St. Leger's forces were at risk and decided to withdraw as well. Americans near Oriskany, led by General Arnold, then focused on surrounding Burgoyne. St. Leger's force eventually arrived in Ticonderoga, but that was too late to help Burgoyne. Burgoyne was still using Native American allies for scouting and as a protection screen, but at the same time, they were raiding American settlements. That helped increase support for the American cause from the local population. Burgoyne thus had problems getting animals and wagons, essential for movement of his forces. During all that time, communication with General Howe was difficult, as most messengers kept getting intercepted. When Burgoyne finally got Howe's letter, it was too late. Howe made it clear he was unavailable for help, as he was to attack Philadelphia. Burgoyne was counting on supplies from Howe, not just troops. Low on supplies, he sent part of his troops to take over some New Hampshire lands to resupply, that led to the Battle of Bennington. Unknown to the British, the Americans in the area managed to raise 1,500 militiamen in just 6 days as a reaction to the fall of Ticonderoga. The British were caught by surprise as they were trying to take supplies. It ended in a sound defeat for the British. While the loss of 900 men and means of resupply was horrible enough for Burgoyne, a rift between him and his Indian allies appeared. Burgoyne blamed them even though they too lost men at Bennington. As a result, most of Indian allied troops left him. During all that time, as Burgoyne was moving slowly, American forces grew. Various militias were assembled, joining the Continental Army. General Gates was sent to Albany to command them. His forces there numbered over 6,000. In addition to that, various American troops and local militia of the area raised by General Lincoln were to join him. At the beginning of September, Burgoyne's forces were on the east side of the River Hudson. Low on supplies and men, he decided not to man the outposts to the north, essentially cutting himself off. He wanted to cross the river while his position was favorable. He was without a proper Indian recon screen, but still he proceeded with the plan and went south. Vanguards of both sides' forces engaged in skirmishes, and Burgoyne basically walked into the area where Gates had set up camp. Burgoyne had little idea of just how numerous American forces were. They were swelling with fresh militiamen each day. He knew Americans had positions nearby and attacked them near Freeman's farm, trying to seize the nearby hill. It amounted to a flanking maneuver against Americans. American left flank went ahead, into the forest, to intercept and slow down the British, as combat in the forest was not the British strong suit. The combat was still confined to the woods, and both sides launched attacks and counterattacks as more and more reinforcements were sent to that western flank. Americans would at times even take British artillery, then lose it. British heavy firepower was of little use in such environment though. But at the same time, the centerline British troops were steadily pushing into the Americans, though at great cost. Throwing in everything they had, the British left their logistics camp very lightly guarded and pushed their rear formations into the fight as well. American eastern flank was thus also under heavy pressure. But evening came, and the Americans decided to use the darkness and retreat to their defensive structures. The British remained on the field. Results of the battle were not very favorable for them, despite the apparent victory. The British pondered whether they should attack the entrenched American positions farther south the next day. Burgoyne ultimately decided not to attack on September 21st when he received a message from Henry Clinton. While General Howe left for Philadelphia, he left Clinton a minor force, but one that could still contribute to their cause. Clinton wrote he was able to push towards Burgoyne, so the British decided to wait. But Clinton's army was slow. The northernmost point he reached was Clermont, still short of Burgoyne's position. During the next 2 weeks, American army grew in size, as more and more militiamen were gathered. Desertions from the British camp were frequent, and through them and captured messengers, the American knew all they had to do is wait, as they knew of British situation. By the early October, Burgoyne's army was so low on supplies that soldiers weren't getting all their daily rations. Some of the generals in the British camp suggested a retreat, but Burgoyne thought it would be perceived as a disgrace. Even though they didn't know how many troops Americans had, the British still decided to push forward. It was October 7th by then. The British sent a force of 1,700 troops to scout the American left flank. The Americans noticed the British movement and went ahead with their own force. After a short but bloody 1 hour exchange of fire, the British forces were in disarray and their lines broke. The Americans gave chase, going after the British, who retreated to a redoubt they had previously erected. Another bloody fight ensued, with the British forced to retreat further. American losses by that point were fairly small, dwarfed by the British. Under the cover of night, the British retreated and eventually reached the position they were at nearly a month earlier. The Americans surrounded them. Eventually, the two sides started discussing the terms of surrender. A few days later, the actual surrender took place. Initial agreement had the British and German troops granted safe passage back to Europe. but the American Congress had later changed their mind and kept all soldiers as prisoners. These battles of Saratoga became regarded as a turning point of the war. While individual battles usually saw hundreds of troops lost, this time the British lost through surrender thousands. More importantly, the French saw the result of the battles as a sign that the British were vulnerable. They started negotiations to ally themselves with the Americans. After such a victory, more and more people were willing to become part of the American army. The war went on for years, but the Americans had secured a serious blow to the British. The battles of Saratoga also showed the importance of communication between army groups, which the British lacked, and deliberate attempts at preventing communications, which Americans excelled at. Logistics were also crucial, as well as denying supplies to the enemy. Finally, the professional soldiers didn't prove themselves to be much more useful, as the Americans managed to make do with militiamen. So, in a way, higher numbers contributed to the morale, and British pride and underestimation of the opponent decided the outcome of the battles. Big thanks goes to all my patrons on Patreon. Without you, we wouldn't be able to make as many videos. Do subscribe if you like my content. And if you want to be notified about new videos, don't forget to click that bell button. And remember, Binkov may talk about hypothetical wars, but only real peace can bring us all together.